Today I'm going to be demonstrating this typical Venetian canal scene. Lots of activity happening on the canal, leaning tower in the distance. It's a small painting. It will end up about roughly 9 by 5 inches. So I've started by doing a simple sketch of the scene, mainly concentrating on getting the perspective right. The eye level in this painting is somewhere about this point, and the vanishing point is somewhere in this area. Now, when you do a scene of Venice, the vanishing point, there is not just one single vanishing point, because it's the canals aren't parallel, and so you've got buildings going every which way, so you have various vanishing points, but generally the vanishing point is going to be somewhere in this region here. Okay, so my first step is to give this painting a light underwash, and then when that dries, we'll go and put the detail on top of that. So first, put some water into my palette. I like to mix my starting colours, even though I quite often then add additional colours onto the wet paper as I go along, but this just gives me a bit of extra time. So for the sky, I'm going to have some cobalt blue. The sky's going to be very weak, but I'm going to add a bit of light, so I'm going to also use some cad orange, maybe a little bit of alizarin. And I'll run this all the way down paper, just testing my colours before I get started. Because this is quite a small painting, I don't have to do a lot of preparation, because I find small paintings get painted very quickly. I don't have to worry too much about things drying too fast. Okay, so the light in this scene is going to be coming from my left. So I'm going to start by adding a bit of blue. When I paint the blue on the coat, this is cobalt blue, a bit of an angle. And then I'll go on with some cad, very pale cad orange. Maybe a tiny bit of pink too as well. Run that up there. I just want a greyish sort of sky with a bit of warmth to it. I'm going to run some of this warmer colour down this side of the canal. And the cool colours down to this side. Bit of coolness in the distance as well. There we go. And for the canal colour itself, or the watercolour, I'm going to mix some very weak cobalt turquoise in the distance, with a little bit of raw umber to it. A little bit of French ultramarine too, it's too bright, that green. As I said, it's a very small painting, so it paints very quickly. I'm going to lighten this colour in the distance by just dropping some water into it, just letting that flow down. There we go. I'm going to hint at these distant reflections as well. Because we're reflecting some of the sky, I'm going to add a little bit of this cad orange into the water here. It's very important to think when you're doing a painting like this, if you change anything from the original reference, you've got to make allowances for the change in the water, change in the what you're actually reflecting. There we go. Now I'll just dry some of this moisture away from the edge. If you're not careful, if you leave it there, sometimes you get these little spheres of water or bubbles of water flowing back onto your paper, and you end up with some not very nice looking cauliflowers or back runs. There we go. We'll now let that dry and then we'll go on to the next step. The painting is now dry. I did use a hairdryer to make sure it was very dry, and I've let it cool down. It's important after you've used a hairdryer that you don't start painting too quickly, otherwise if the paper is still warm and you start painting on that, the water on your mix will dry too fast and you can create a bit of a muddy mess. So here's the reference photo that I'm working on, and but it's a little bit dull here, so I'm going to add some light coming through the gap between these two buildings here, but I want to create a feeling of recession in my painting. So to do that, I'm going to start with some stronger colors, stronger tones here, and which will soften and lighten as I move into the distance, and then I'll do the reverse on this side, softer, cooler colors here, and then stronger colors as I come forward. So initially I'll start mixing my colors on this side. When I do a painting like this, I don't try and match every colours exactly or anything like that. I'm really just trying to capture the feeling of the place. And if you've ever been to Venice, there's something quite unique about it, and I love that old world texture, living on the water type feeling anyway. So I'll start by mixing these colours here. For that, I'm going to just use this cobalt blue mix that I've got here. Probably too much water in that mixture, so I'm going to take some of that moisture out. Otherwise I'll have to add so much colour to get the right tone. It'll be a bit of a waste. So I'll start with some burnt sienna, because it's primarily a brownish sort of mixture, a colour on the walls. And this will be one of my stronger tones. So I have a sheet of paper here that I test my colours on. Make it a bit stronger. And I might add a little bit of raw umber to that mix as well, just to lighten colour a bit. I'll remove some more of this water, because I'm not going to need that. And I'm going to also mix a little bit of a dark here with some French ultramarine and burnt sienna, just to hint at some of the windows. And it's quite a bit stronger, very little water in that mixture. And some in there. by mixing some of that into here, I'll just create two different colours. I'm going to start with this. I don't have a set way of attacking this other than I do like to let the colours flow and create a bit of random effect. And I like to leave lots of bits of paper that are untouched. That's a bit strong, so I'm going to just run a bit of water down there. That will immediately lighten. I think it's going to have light coming through here. I'm going to leave most of that untouched at this stage. Veranda there. I think we'll run this for most of that. Into that same mixture, I'll just take some of that mixture over here and then add more water to it to create a lighter version. Bridge has a little pale outline. I won't paint into that section. Okay. Just vary this a little bit. I'd like to add a bit more warmth to this, so I'm going to run a little bit of alizarin crimson down. There we go. The top here. Just running this water off the page so I don't get any cauliflowers, at least unwanted cauliflowers. Okay, now the main tower is a light creamy colour, so I'm just going to create a little bit of yellow ochre, lots of water. Later I'll come back and put a bit of detail to this shape. I'm just going to soften that edge before it gets too hard. And Now before this dries too much, I'm going to come back in some very thick paint. Just French ultramarine, burnt sienna, maybe a bit of raw umber. This way I can get some in-between, what I call in-between edges that aren't too hard and not too soft. It's drying a little bit faster. I'm just going to give it a very light spraying. What the spraying does, it puts the shine back on the paper, but more importantly gives me a little bit more time to think through what I'm doing. That'll do. I'll put some more detail in that later. There's slightly lighter versions of that here. There we go. It's important not to spray directly onto the paper, or else you'll push the paint away. I spray like over the top like this, and only the very finest droplets land on my paper. This building has a little bit of pink in it, so I'm going to do that, but add a bit of blue to keep that feeling of recession. And this tower has a bit of pink. Add some more cobalt blue to the mixture. Maybe some French ultramarine. The images here become less distinct as well, because the further something is away from you, the more the atmosphere removes clarity. I'll hint at some of these windows, but very lightly. You know, I'm happy for some of the pencil marks to show through anyway. There we go, some nice recession there. Now this wall here is very stark looking between the two buildings. So I'm going to now just very lightly run pale wash of some sort of beige colour. But because these walls have been painted quite a bit earlier, they've well and truly stained the paper, so I don't get immediate lots of bleeding through. A little bit is fine, that just adds to the character, but not too much. Now in the distance, I think this is way over the other side of the canal, I'm going to just throw in some shapes, fairly indistinct, paint around this figure. You don't always have to paint around figures, you can always add some gouache later if you lose a highlight or something like that, but if I can, I do. It just allows me to paint a lot quicker. There we go. So I'll use more yellow ochre in my mixture. As I come forward. I use quite a bit of water in my mix, but I also use quite a lot of paint. So I aim to create a flowy mixture of watercolour and water, so that you'll see as I put paint onto my paper, it still flows down the page. And that's that flowing action that gives you that nice smooth finish on a watercolour paper. That was a bright green kiosk here, so I'm just going to use, or dark green, not a bright green, sorry, a bit of cobalt turquoise, touch of burnt sienna, and some French ultramarine, not too much detail, and I'll let some of those colours bleed into the background as well. I'll lighten this over here a little bit, it's a bit too strong, so I'm just going to drop some water into it. Now for the footpath, I'm just going to use some cobalt blue for the burnt sienna. And it'll have a little bit of a brown tinge from all the other colours I've already added. Adjust some of these distant colours. I'll now do a bit of work on this bridge. These buildings should have been brought down to the water's edge, so I'll just add a little bit of colour there. I'm now going to work on some of the little details before I do the reflections of this painting. Raw umber and cad red, just to create a bit of a warm flesh colour. I'm not trying to draw these too accurately. I might add some of these boats now. Darker areas away from the light. Whenever you draw, you have to make sure everything's in the right proportion. Little shapes I don't worry too much about. I can always adjust them later if I need to. just going to lighten this a little bit, just a bit too stark for my liking. Because I'm using cold press paper, it's actually quite easy to lift these little adjustments. There. I'm going to mix a shadow colour of just with a French ultramarine to alizarin. I don't want this to be too strong, it can just be a bit stronger than that. A shadow underneath here. Just there. Don't worry too much about these little marks in the sky that, because it's a pale sky, they're easily gotten rid of. And if they're not too big, they can become one of the ubiquitous seagulls, or sorry, pigeons that you find flying around Venice. There we go. Just about ready to do the reflections now. I'm just going to soften this. It's a bit too sharp an edge for my liking. By softening that, that'll just push it back that extra little bit. We're now going to do the main reflections, the buildings and the water. So the colours, the reflections are obviously are going to be similar to the objects you're reflecting, but they're going to be modified by the colour of the water. So in this case, most of the reflections will be a brown with a little bit of a green in colour. Well, I'll just mix that into the colours I've already got here. A little bit of cobalt turquoise into the mix. That'll be a green mixture. And because these are quite dark shapes, the reflections will probably be just a little bit lighter. Obviously they're going to be darker on this side and lighter over here as well. So I've mixed my colours and add a little bit of water to my brush. This is from water to dilute it in the distance. It's still not strong enough. So. keep changing the colour. Yeah, the important thing is to make sure the reflections are all at least below the objects you're reflecting. Obviously they don't have to be totally exact, because the water, as it undulates, changes the effect of the reflections. Green here. There, we'll just come on here, we'll do the same. Just soften this edge to let some of that colour bleed up. Okay. And just lift a little bit. There. And that will probably do for that side. We'll now work on this other side. A lot more light here, so these reflections will be not as strong. Before this dries completely, I'm just going to spray it lightly to just add a bit more moisture, because I want to hint at the reflection, the underneath part of this bridge, which you can't see when looking forward, but if you're looking down you will. And if you look at this photo here, you can just see a hint of that reflection. It's not always critical, but when I can, I like to put it in. That'll do. and some of these timber bollards. Main thing is to make them quite varied in shape and not too regular. There we go. That just breaks up that line. I'm just going to finish a few little details and this painting should be done. Just going to throw a little bit more detail in this area. Not too much. overdo some of these finishing touches. That'll do. Now all I have to do is sign this. Because it was designed to fit into a 9x5 frame, put the mat on up to that size and then work out where I'm going to sign it and then sign it. Colour that suits my painting. Sometimes I sign it in red, sometimes in another colour. There we go. That is finished.